Yo, what up? It's the tip of the week, and today we're going to discuss how to prevent lingual nerve damage. All right, guys. So if you're new to the channel, I'm Dr. Jared Williams. I'm a concierge dental surgeon out in Houston, Texas. And basically what that means is I go to several offices doing third molars, implants, and also IV sedation. And so the reason why I created this channel is simply so you, the doctor, can smile after surgery, but not just you, but your whole entire staff. And so with the 10,000 surgeries that I've completed and working with over 30 different practices in a 10-year time frame, I believe I have some good tips that could potentially take your career to the next level. So sit back, relax, and get excited, because if you take out third molars and you want to prevent lingual nerve damage, then this is the video for you. All right, guys, so welcome. Once again, I'm Dr. Jared Williams, and what we're gonna do is we're gonna go over a couple of items to prevent lingual nerve damage. It's not something that you ever wanna deal with. As a matter of fact, I've never had to deal with it simply because I follow these simple principles. But if you're watching this up to this point, I want you to smash a like button, hit subscribe, share with your friends. My whole purpose is to get the world to smile after surgery. Without further ado, let's jump into it. All right, so number one is this. You wanna make sure that you don't do anything stupid, all right? And what I mean by stupid is this. Anytime you're creating your flaps, and I'll put a picture up here so you can see it. Anytime you're creating your flaps, you wanna make sure you stay on the buckle side of the tube. Anytime you're creating laying flaps, you wanna make sure you do not pass the central fossa. So basically, if you were to get a hot cross bun and you go right down the middle of that cross bun, if you take tooth number 12 in the occlusal surface, I mean a 12 year molar in the occlusal surface on the lower, what it'll do is it'll be broken down in a hot cross bun. That's what they taught us in anatomy. Shout out to Dr. Tyus out in Meharry Medical College. But anyways, you wanna stay on the buccal side. As soon as you cross that central fossa of the adjacent tooth that you're working on, all hell can potentially break loose. Now, typically speaking, it's always good to know your anatomy. And so by knowing your anatomy, you are gonna know exactly where that lingual nerve is gonna be. Generally doesn't sit up at the crest of the alveolar bone on the lingual. Generally it's a little bit lower, but I don't even try to figure that out. I don't even care, because you shouldn't care either, because if you follow these principles, you'll never, I'll say never, I'm gonna go out there and say, if you don't even cross the central fossa of the adjacent tooth that you're taking out, then you don't have to deal with it. And that's adjacent tooth that is on the lower jaw. So if you're taking out the lower third molars, stay on the buccal side. One more time, the buccal side. Repeat after me, the buccal side. Don't go towards the tongue. Stay on the buccal side of the tooth. And by doing that, you're gonna prevent yourself from all trauma. So keep that in mind. Number two is this, don't be stupid. Don't watch this video and disregard everything I say and let me get more. And by doing that, what I mean is that it's like you wanna get more access so you could see, so you wanna just creep it over. Guys, don't do it. It's not a good idea. When about 6 years ago, maybe 8 years ago, one of my mentors out in Ohio, he was telling me about a case that was presented to him. There was a patient, 16-year-old girl, was getting the third molars out, and the doctor was wanting to either make money or help the person, or I don't know what the heck they were thinking. But he decided to lay a flap. He got the teeth out successfully. Patient came back for a post-op, and yes, you guessed it. The idiot who created paresthesia didn't just do it on the right side, but he did it on the left side as well. Now, I'm all for giving people grace and mercy. However, when it gets to the stages of being egregious, then there has to be an issue. And what I mean by this is, don't be stupid. Don't do anything that you haven't trained for or paid the money or paid the consequences, AKA, you know, it's not always gonna be money that you have to pay, but, you know, get the cases in, you know, humble yourself at the feet of individuals who've been there, done that, and who could write 100 books and get them all published on the first time. Get the education. Don't be stupid. Like, I feel sorry for this kid, because now, you know, I want to say at that point in time, it's been about a couple of months to where the patient came back and got it addressed. And the longer the patient has an insult to a nerve, the worse the prognosis is going to be. All right, so I really want you to know that, so that if you're going to take out wisdom teeth, they could be very fun, it could be very profitable. How do I know? 10,000 cases later, I think I'm at that point now. Like, don't be stupid. Don't just jump in and think that, oh, let me just disregard the principles and be stupid, and then, oh, I have to deal with my malpractice, or you have to deal with, you know, the patient or the patient's parents, or just following up that patient. And then most importantly, I think it's the worst, is losing confidence. You know, when you get into dentistry specifically, on the surgical side, and I would say venture out to say on all sides of dentistry, it's just like, once you lose your confidence, you're cooked. And doing stupid things basically, you know, can only help you for a little bit of time, but the seeds that you plant today will come to harvest. And if you do stupid stuff, expect to get stupid things handed to you, such as lawsuits, such as losing your license, such as getting fired, such as, you know, having to pay the price for being dumb. And so I really want to double down on this, because, you know, I very seldom jump on you guys and probably like, oh man, Dr. Williams, don't be so hard. No, screw that bull crap. No, don't do dumb stuff. Like, the reason why I created my channel is so that the world could smile after surgery. And I erroneously said it's for the doctor. No, if you're doing this appropriately, you're not going to just benefit yourself. You're going to benefit the patient, your assistant, your office manager, your family, your CPA, you know, your accountant. Like, it goes on and on and on, and then you'll be a gem in your community wherever you are in this globe. And so I really want to double down on this. Don't be stupid, all right? So very soon I jump on individuals for things of that nature, but I really want you to focus on, like, follow the principles. They're here for a reason. If you need a good recommendation for a book, I got you. If you need a course, I have that as well. If you need just some one-on-one training, that's all afforded to you. But don't ever, ever do stupid stuff and say, I didn't know, because there are consequences. And it's not even all about financial, but there's somebody on the other side of that 15 blade that is expecting you to provide excellent care. And if you do stupid things, that's going to affect them, how they see dentistry, how their friends see dentistry, how their family members see dentistry, and then just how the other professions see us when we are in the news for these things that could be avoided. So once again, don't do anything stupid, because unfortunately, that could be irreversible. Last but not least is this: refer your patient out immediately. If you feel as if you had your patient have a paresthesia, specifically in lingual nerve or even inferior nerve, you know, get that checked out immediately, because the longer that there is no treatment, the worse off it is. There was a time when I was treating a patient, and she was 36, Hispanic female. Now her nerve was like my finger, and it was like the roots were like this. And I told her, I was just like, hey, you are going to have paresthesia. She was like, take it out. I don't care. It's bothering me. It's bothering me. It's bothering me. Take it out. I told her, you will have a paresthesia. I let her know before we even got started. So when she came back, she followed up with me. She did have a paresthesia. It's like my second one out of like 10,000 cases. I'm cool with those numbers because I let her know she was on board with it. I followed standard of care. One thing I could have done is did a coronectomy, but, you know, you can't cry for spilled milk, but, you know, it is what it is. And so I followed up with her. She ended up getting a little bit more of her feeling back to where she's almost recovered. But one thing that you definitely want to do is don't allow the patients to just sit and fester. And what I mean by that is this: in the event that you cause a paresthesia, what you need to do is follow up them with some steroids, get them to come back in 1 week or 1 day, depending on what you've done. And then if you've done all those things and it's still out of your scope of practice, get them to a referral or neurologist or a surgeon, oral surgeon that could definitely manage the situation, that is well versed in nerve damage. All right, not everybody can manage this. I don't care what type of training you have. Not everybody wants to take care of it. Not everybody can take care of it. So get with a specialist, generally this closest university that's in your location, or the top surgeon or neurologist that's in your area, so they can manage this, the area that you created a paresthesia. Some things that you don't want to have happen is this: is that when, just like if I were to, you know, cut my forearm with a knife, and it could scab over and it could keloid and it could get all disfigured. The same thing could happen with your nerves. And sometimes what happens is this, is that when the nerve does not heal appropriately, and just FYI, nerves are some of the longest regenerating body parts that regenerate. And so since it takes a long time, sometimes what could also happen is that the nerves could end up, opposed to coming to a synapsis like this, what they'll do is they'll start curling on themselves and potentially causing some other challenges that cause a whole nother issues that you don't, I'm not even going to, because I'm not even qualified to talk about it. But you know, it's one of those things, it just makes it worse. Also, I want to say is this, it just makes it worse. So if you cause damage, be woman enough to go ahead and look your patient in the eye, just like I'm looking at you right now, and saying, hey ma'am, sir, here's a challenge. What I want you to do is I want you to follow up with this surgeon. I want to follow up with you and stick with them. You know, if you do something like this, regardless if you do something good or bad, just stick with your patients, because you never know how building that rapport in the midst of adversity could do some greater things on the latter part of time. And so even with the patient that I had, that I created paresthesia with, and once again, hear my language, I created, I'm taking ownership for that. Even the patient that I created that paresthesia on, and she knew, I still followed up with her and she's doing well to this day. And like I said, that, I don't know if I told you this, but that was probably about 4 or 5 years ago, maybe about three to four years ago. And she's doing better now. So just wanted to throw that out here. These are the tips on how you're able to prevent a lingual nerve paresthesia. And so another thing is this, be careful. Here's a little bonus tip. What I want you to do is be careful when you're retracting. I see a lot of videos on YouTube, all these doctors are doing a lot of surgeries and they're putting a post up. Be very leery when you see these, because it's good to see it, but one thing that I was taught at Meharry is this. The reason why we are called doctors is because we know why to do it. Not, oh, I could do it. I see, monkey do, let me just do it, I gotta do it. No, no, no. You need to know why it's doing, why people are doing what they're doing, not just seeing a surgery on YouTube and then applying it to your patient. No, 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 no. The reason why you're gonna smile at the surgery and not everybody around you is because you're gonna know exactly why. And I would say this is probably one of the reasons why my channel is one of the best channels out there, is because I'm gonna go in depth on these procedures so that you just don't say, okay, Dr. Williams told me to do that, so I'll smile after surgery. No, I'm gonna tell you exactly why. I'm gonna go a little bit in depth, probably a little bit more than you would probably initially anticipate. But the reason why I want to do this is because I want you to know why. Because since you're the doctor, if you're not going to go out and do the research, I'll do it for you, and I'll make it convenient and educational and also entertaining as well, as best I possibly can, so that you can literally smile at surgery. All right, guys, so once again, I'm Dr. Jared Williams, and my focus is for you, yeah, you, to smile at surgery. So what I want you to do is this: hit the like button, smash subscribe, and share this with your colleagues, because once again, there's no way I'm gonna be able to get the whole world to smile at surgery if you don't assist. All right, guys, so if you saw this video and you're like, Dr. Williams, you're too hard on me, well, smash the dislike button. But if you do, type in the comments below why it wasn't beneficial for you, so that we could look at what we're doing and give you the best possible. All right, guys, so once again, remember, what looks hard is often easy. Make it a great one.